changemakers. Solutions Live is a monthly production. Each month we take on a complex front burner social issue and bring together journalists, experts, changemakers, trying to create a productive conversation that helps reporters cover a complex social issue and the corresponding responses. This month, we are taking on an issue that really could not be more front burner, which is healthcare. In the wake of the debate and resolution for now, the Affordable Care Act, what's next? How do we resolve this sort of torturous tension between access and quality? So we're looking forward to really robust conversation. And we hope that all of you on the call will join in. If you go to the bottom of your screen, you will see a button called Q&A. If you want to ask a question, just click on that button and type a question. We'll work that into the conversation. So that said, I'd like to introduce my former SJN colleague, Sarika Bansal, who is founder and editor of the development set, publication focused on international health and development issues. Sarika.
Hi, everyone. Really nice to be here. Thank you all for taking time out of your busy schedules to join us. As Keith mentioned, we are interested in helping journalists tell better stories about the federal healthcare system. And this feels like an issue that I've been wondering myself, you know, how do we report on it better? How do we ask the right questions? How do we make sure we have our focus in on the right topics as opposed to just talking about the horse race aspects of how healthcare seems to be moving in this country? So I'm hoping that this whole hour will feel really service-oriented and will help you up your game in that way. We have three fantastic panelists with us, and Rushika Fernando-Pule, I hope we pronounced that correctly, Kavita Patel, and Bob Master, who will be guiding us from their perspectives on what they think journalists need to know about reporting on healthcare. So I'd love for each of you to briefly introduce yourselves and maybe start with answering that exact question. Like, you know, if there were one thing that you wish journalists would understand better about reporting on healthcare, what would it be? So Rushika, maybe we'll start with you.
Sure, so it's great to be here. Thank you very much. My name is Rushika Fernando-Pule. I'm a primary care physician and I'm co-founder and CEO of a company called Iora Health. I'm also a proud Ashoka fellow. What we do is trying to build a new model of care delivery from the ground up, starting with primary care. So build sort of new primary care systems that are focused not on what the current healthcare system does, which is doing more things to people, document coding and billing, but really focus on improving people's health and keeping them out of trouble. If there's one thing I think for journalists to think about, is focus on how actual people get actual care. There's so much going on in healthcare right now that's what I call putzing around the edges. And fundamentally, if we don't change the production process of care itself, change how actual people get actual care, nothing will change.
Great. Let's hope to explore that very theme much more during this hour, exactly how the supply side can change. Fantastic. Kavita, would you like to introduce yourself?
Sure. Hi there. Kavita Patel. And I spend time at the Brookings Institution, and I also work as a primary care physician in Washington, D.C. And if there's one thing, I worked on the Affordable Care Act. If there's one thing that I think journalists in general, and then specifically healthcare journalists, could really understand, it's how to actually tie a lot of the acronyms and kind of complex policy and regulatory pieces that tend to pervade Washington, D.C. to real stories. So in the White House, we used to joke about trying to find real people to explain things. And I think that's probably the number one connection that we need to do a better job of in terms of reporting.
Could you give an example?
So a lot of people have been talking about essential health benefits as part of the American Health Care Act. And I think it's, and this is not to say that all media is a certain way, But it's really lost on most people, kind of even, I think most people would think that their insurance actually has essential health benefits. So something that is kind of a term of policy, which is very much a relevant term because that's what the Freedom Caucus is arguing about. It's what politicians are arguing about, but it doesn't mean much to people. And I think that unfortunately, when I pick up a newspaper article or a magazine article, I feel like I understand what's going on, but when I show things to patients, even very educated, highly health literate patients, they absolutely have no idea what's really happening.
Mm-hmm. Some may say that healthcare is complicated. Yeah. Bob, what about you? I'd love for you to introduce yourself and tell us one thing that you wish journalists understood better.
Thank you so much. It's really such an honor to be here and a part of this. I agree completely with Kavita and Rashika in what they've said. I'm also a physician, still at it, and been spending a lifetime caring for people, low-income individuals with complex medical and social challenges, and also they present the government the greatest financial challenge. And I also have developed and created organizations in the social entrepreneurial space to try to improve the care delivery system. If there is actually one thing that I would add to Kavita and Rashika, it would be a discussion about Medicaid. That Medicaid is so much more than just a health insurer. Medicaid, and not to mention a vilified, marginalized health insurer, as we hear in so much of the verbiage, that it is really an engine of a human rights revolution. And I'd love to be able to explore that more.
Huh. What do you mean it's an engine of the human rights revolution?
We can get into it because these were populations at another time and another place that were warehoused, essentially wards of the state, institutionalized. And Medicaid uniquely has developed benefit packages and designs over decades to promote independence and autonomy, such as personal care assistant benefits, and a whole range of home and community benefits that allow inclusion. And I'd love to get into that because Medicaid has been all too vilified in this recent debate.
Yeah, absolutely. Actually, let's get into Medicaid a little bit because that is one of the topics that I had wanted to discuss. And I know Kavita has very strong opinions on this as well. I know that it's arguably one of the most complex and unique pieces of the American healthcare system. It also, I was reading recently an article about how Medicaid started, and it was almost a blip when it was introduced in Lyndon Johnson's new healthcare plan in the 60s. And now it's, it insures so many Americans, and it has such a complex web of how it works in different states. So first of all, I mean, do you guys have any tips on what journalists should understand about Medicaid that maybe from recent reporting you think is overlooked or misunderstood? Yeah, go ahead, Bob. Yeah.
Oh, well, first of all, most people, if you hear the verbiage, think that Medicaid is essentially a health insurance program for recipients needing financial assistance, the old welfare model, AFDC, moms and kids. And it started like that. But starting in the 1970s up to the present, it's so much more than that. 75 to 80% of the dollars go to people with involved physical, developmental, or mental illness related disabilities and their elderly counterparts in need of low income services. And that's real. And Medicaid uniquely has created, as I said, benefit designs that promote independence and autonomy. And I mentioned one as an example, personal care assistant benefit, a whole range of home and community benefits. And quite frankly, I believe that this Medicaid has been the engine that has been critical to the closure of the warehouse and the institution and the bench clinics. And a whole constituencies are living independently and a part of it also is an engine of healthcare innovation in terms of its financing models that allow more appropriate primary care and more appropriate home and community and independent functioning than otherwise would occur here. And so you don't see these things in other forms of insurance. You see it in Medicaid.
How has it been a driver of innovation in particular?
In our experience, the way you take care of complicated populations are through global payments, not fee for service, accountable clinical entities that allow redesign. And Rashika knows, so much about that. And Medicaid was actually the first to have risk-adjusted global payments that went to clinical organizations. Now that is a centerpiece of the ACA and the centerpiece of the care delivery transformation, as one example, as well as the benefit designs. You don't see people having benefits of personal care assistance in commercial insurance, health insurance, or for kids that have a technology dependence, those kind of benefits. Medicaid has spread from 3 or 4 million people in 1967 to 70 million people today, as the only insurer for these kind to promote independence. And that's, I think, the points I wanted to make and get into.
Fantastic. What about Rashika, Kavitha? I'd love to hear from you guys as well.
Yeah, so I obviously agree with Bob. So I guess a couple points I'd like to make. One is, as Bob said, everyone talks about Medicaid and they think about the women and the children and, people low income. That's a tiny percentage of what Medicaid spends money on. The vast majority of Medicaid patients, what they spend money on are really complex patients. And these people are hard, not just medically, but they have a whole host of mental and social issues as well. And by the way, we're going to end up paying for these people anyway, right? Because they're going to turn up in hospitals and we're not going to say no to them. And it's really stupid to do that and not pay for the upfront, right? Because we know for a fact that if we can address these medical, social, and mental health issues upfront in a primary care setting, we can make huge impacts on them showing up in places like hospitals. And hospitals are the worst place to take care of them because it's really, really expensive. So these are hard people. We're going to pay for them anyway. So we need to do it smartly. So Bob said, I think the only models that really work in this space is to get out of the medical mindset, we'll pay for this and not that, we'll pay for drugs and medical stuff, because most of the things that actually help them have nothing to do with that. So we need to loosen the rules, let people be creative at the point of care in figuring out what to do, right? Keeping people accountable, as Bob said. And then there's a fair amount of that. I think this is where a lot of the innovation is happening. If there's one thing I would change and I would focus on, it's actually the time course. So one of the things that Bob and I, and those of us who do this for a living, have found out is, it takes a while to fix the problem. Thinking that we can take a really complex population of people and in 3-6 months really impact their cost trend is just fooling ourselves, right? These are behavior changes, it's hard. This is 2, 3, 4 years. And the problem with Medicaid is too often Medicaid agencies are fixing this 1-year budget cycle. So they may find it really hard to invest in something that they can't get the payoff this year. Well, that's stupid. That just won't happen, right? And then a lot of the Medicaid programs are built in a way that people churn on and off Medicaid, which is even worse. So we make these investments in people, and then 2 months later, they're off of not our problem anymore, and we don't get the benefit. So I think U.S. healthcare in general, but Medicaid in particular, needs to think about this not in 1-year increments, but in a longer-term time horizon, and figure out ways to sort of allow us to think in those longer horizons.
Huh. I love the idea, the kind of reframing that you did of thinking about Medicaid almost as a preventive health. You know, so it's like you prevent so many much larger health costs down the road if you're able to make sure that people are continually insured right now and are able to get their basic healthcare needs met at a much smaller level.
And it's about, this is not just a theory. Bob's been doing this for 20 years. We've been doing this for 5 or 6. And all of us who've done this seriously show 40, 50% drop in hospitalization. These are not little numbers, these are big numbers. We can make huge impacts on costs. But again, if we have the people are able to be creative in how we meet their needs, again, I think preventive medicine is maybe the wrong way to put it, because this is a preventive life, right? We often say with these populations, the goal is actually help them fix their life. That helps them improve their health, that keeps them out of trouble, that generates the economics we need. But you've got to get that whole chain right, which often focuses on helping them improve their life. I think in the UK, they're doing a lot of interesting things, trying to combine the social service payments, the housing and education with the healthcare payments, because it actually makes sense. And I think in our little siloed programs, it's often a problem.
Mm-hmm. You said so many things that I think for any solutions-oriented journalist would be such gold. First, you know, like looking at the UK as maybe, you know, a hub of innovation in terms of combining both healthcare and things like housing, that's something that just as a concept would be so great for any journalist to explore, as well as, you know, thinking about any program that can reduce hospitalization rates by 40-50%. Those are huge numbers. So I think that for any, for all journalists watching this, I think those are two areas that if I were you, I would look into more. Kavitha, what about you?
So I'll take a different tack and talk a little bit about what's kind of been in the policy domain. So you're hearing a lot from the Trump administration and from kind of GOP members about more flexibility in Medicaid or the need to allow for states to do things. And then you've heard about, I think, some very dangerous ideas around what's called per capita caps or block grants in the Medicaid program. You pointed out that, you know, Medicaid, when it was first signed into law, was actually not really kind of the original intention of the Social Security Act. And interestingly enough, like now Medicaid, by 2020, there will be more people likely enrolled in Medicaid than in Medicare, which is the program for the elderly that gets a lot more attention. So I think that from a policy standpoint, there's this desire to try to, quote, bring down cost in Medicaid. Medicaid is one of the, from an economic perspective, Medicaid is one of the most efficient cost programs you can get. There's not a lot of, unlike commercial insurance, which I have and most of us have, unlike Medicare, which there you could argue there's a lot of kind of waste and potential overutilization. Medicaid, because of people like Bob, have been practicing in very lean circumstances. So cost growth in Medicaid has actually been less than in any other insurance program. And so the desire that policymakers have to kind of think about, quote, ways to make it efficient or ways to rein in cost, at the end of the day, what we're really doing is we're shortchanging care. So Medicaid, and then people talk about Medicaid like it's one program because it's easy to talk about it that way. It's actually like 50 programs plus the territories. Medicaid program in the state of Maryland pays for heating. Medicaid program in Puerto Rico looks totally different. So the federal responsibility as taxpayers, our responsibility is to kind of help pay into a trust fund that helps to match what states pay in Medicaid. But the actual administration of the program, the design of the program, is incredibly heterogeneous. And so if we're looking to have some opinion or opine, you know, so for journalists, in talking or reporting or thinking about Medicaid, it's very kind of important to think about how different the Medicaid programs are and how different states have responded to their concerns about budgets that are kind of being eaten up by the Medicaid program. And I think fundamentally our country is having a discussion on whether we think healthcare is a human right, which is really how I frame all these discussions around policy, particularly not just around Medicaid, but around the Affordable Care Act.
That's fantastic framing. Are there any states that you think are doing a particularly noteworthy job around how they approach Medicaid?
I mean, I think that in the Affordable Care Act, a lot of the flexibility that the Republican caucus and the Trump administration desire are actually baked into the Affordable Care Act through state innovation waivers. And through some of these waivers, we've seen a lot of people talk about the states like California, New York. I'm going to just talk about some of the states that don't get as much attention. Arkansas, Colorado. I'll give you an example. Colorado has been doing a lot to integrate behavioral health into like aspects of the delivery of care in Medicaid, mostly through community health centers, but also throughout other physicians who take Medicaid. The state of Arkansas has actually changed their payment model in Medicaid around certain areas to do what we're calling bundled payments. And then they're also doing some innovations in Medicaid to help people get access to care more quickly in very high need specialty areas. So we know that in Medicaid, for example, getting access to high quality specialty care can sometimes take months because of just the fact that people don't take Medicaid as doctors. Right. So you can, I mean, right there, I've probably got like 10 story ideas that have just come from what I just said. And going deeper into these things can offer great insights into, like I said, a very heterogeneous program.
That's fantastic. I mean, I don't know if there's anyone on the line right now from Arkansas. If you are, like, please make yourself known. But I think that, like, knowing that they do something like bundled healthcare is really fantastic. And that's something new information for me. Actually, on a similar note, one of the questions that we've gotten from Paige Blankenbuehler, I hope I pronounced your last name correctly, is about in rural counties and rural areas, are there any, maybe we can just stick to looking at the Medicaid ones, but are there any insurers or anyone who's doing anything to help people in rural areas access healthcare more easily?
I can jump in, and I'm familiar with a program that was absolutely a groundbreaking in central northern Wisconsin called Community Health Partnership. And this speaks to, I think, very important points that both Rashik and Kavita were trying to make here, in that what Medicaid was in that program and in the work that we do are really the underpinnings of innovation. So this was, Community Health Partnership had enrolled 5,000 to 6,000 people with very involved clinical conditions such as serious mental illness, developmental disabilities, frail elders at extraordinary risk for nursing home placement, put together in the, across a swath of hundreds of miles. I think Eau Claire, Wisconsin was the epicenter, interdisciplinary teams to bring medical care and primary care into the home, the development of individualized care plans, and all sorts of using Medicaid and Medicare dollars as alternatives to hospital and institutional care. And the key point that I think that Rashika made this point, Medicaid is could be an extraordinary cost driver. But in fact, if you organize care correctly, you can reduce the real cost drivers such as hospital care and then downstream long-term institutional care very, very substantially, very, very substantially. And it's still going to be expensive, but what we do have is as an engine of innovation for social entrepreneurs, like people at the Community Health Partnership Program that I talked about. And by the way, that was ended not because it wasn't performing over many, many years, but it was ended ideologically because the Wisconsin governor a few years ago did not want to have these integrated programs that were cornerstones of the ACA, and ended that, much to the pain and suffering of his own constituents there. But that is that essentially, I think, is the key points here, that we take a great deal of pride in our in being Ashoka fellows, because the word of social entrepreneurial approach is there. What gives us that opportunity is the structure of the ACA, and is the structure previously of Medicaid over many years and decades. We would not have a space for social entrepreneurial flexibility. We do with this.
Just to highlight, Bob, I think one of the key issues with healthcare is that it is local, right? So I think this is not like, we've been building practice around the country, and there's a New York Times article about it called the Starbucks of healthcare, and I wish it was that easy, right? Because if you want to build Starbucks, you could put essentially the same coffee shop everywhere and create 1,000 copies. There's a great quote, I think, from Anna Karenina, happy families are all alike, unhappy families are unhappy in their own way. And I think when you get to these sicker people and these folks who are the people who need help, I'm thinking you can do the same thing across the country in exactly the same way with top-down solutions. That's just fooling ourselves, right? And I think, as Bob said, everything I've ever seen that's been successful has been bottom-up and responds to the needs of that community and what's going on and the culture of that community. What the people at the top need to do is set the rules to allow entrepreneurs to figure this stuff, social entrepreneurs to figure this stuff out. And it will look different in different places. And we should judge them whether they're successful or not. I think to the point of how do you get this stuff in rural areas, we need a lot of innovation. The current healthcare model of in-person visits and you know, a lot of this sort of institution-based bricks and mortar, that doesn't work in many rural areas just because of the density of population. The great news is we have all these great new technologies, right? And I think we need to have the flexibility to create sort of new, the problem isn't insurers really in rural areas, it's providers in rural areas, right? You can have the best insurance plan in the world. If there are no people to actually take care of you, it's irrelevant. Right, so I think insurance is a means to an end. And I think some interesting stuff, so another Ashoka fellow, Sanjeev Arora, the great thing called Project Echo, which is managing very complex folks with FC, et cetera, through sort of experts in one place, telemedicine over to maybe not even doctors in other places and teaching them how to do this and being able to do it in a very distributed way. So I think technology and the stuff that's happening gives us the ability to serve these rural areas, but we need to be willing to think out of the current. We need a physical doctor's office and a physical hospital, et cetera.
Right, and especially as things like live streaming technology, including Zoom, become more prevalent and more popular, I could imagine there could be similar ones like specifically for healthcare that are promising to look at.
Well, part of the problem though, so I actually tried to help Sanjeev take his model and try to think about how you could kind of extrapolate that for like all of the Medicare program. And here's a great example of like the conundrum you face when you find something that's just as great as Iora or Project Echo for a rural area. In fact, number one, people classified his program as education. And right now in the Medicare program, we actually really don't subsidize education. So what I would suggest is that there's got to be some flexibility for allowing innovation to happen. And then there has to be some really like hard work of how do we then take promising models? Because, you know, Rashika's right. If it were that easy to be a Starbucks, then everybody would do it, but that the work is very hard. And then, so kind of how can we take this flexibility from a policy standpoint and bring these ideas forward without pushing people like Sanjeev, you know, kind of a square peg into a round hole and totally changing what he does. And so that's really the conundrum. And then on the rural part of it, anytime I worked in the United States Senate, anytime we talked about rural issues, there were immediately a backlash because of the desire. Rural places and rural providers have very distinct exemptions and different payments for the way they deliver care by nature of the fact that they're rural. And so there's a very kind of, there's this very interesting element that occurs politically of like, no, we're not going to touch rural health care because it's already very well funded or it has special funding. And so you can see how complex all of this is. You can't just have just a good idea. You've also got to figure out how do you pay for it, how do you scale it, and how do you think about regulating it so that unintended consequences don't occur. And that's partly why I hate the idea of us just talking about, you know, programs like Medicaid with like one broad fell swoop. It's very different.
Right. I wanted to go to one of the other questions that we got. Thank you so much for everyone who's participating in the Q&A. I hope we'll be able to get to most of them. But specifically, I kind of related to what all of you have been talking about, which David Lipoff, from a solutions reporting standpoint, what are your thoughts about some of the, quote, access to healthcare networks that have been operating in several states that help people who don't have insurance, quote, make it look like they do, and then funnel them into healthcare providers who volunteer their professional service and, in essence, adopt these people as patients, treat them, refer them, et cetera. So do you have any thoughts on these types of networks, and have they done anything for healthcare quality and also for the cost of care? I don't know if any of you have experience with them. All right. Another topic that I wanted to make sure to hit on, and I know Rashika, you work on this in particular, is thinking about pools of people who drive healthcare costs, you know, whether they are people with multiple chronic illnesses or people nearing the end of life. Of course, in the US, people who, those populations make up the bulk of our healthcare costs. And I wanted to ask again from a solutions-oriented perspective, if you knew of any particular innovations or any programs that were working with these populations to help bring down their cost of care, and and perhaps, you know, addressing their problems earlier before they have, before all these healthcare costs pile up. So just wondering if any of you have any thoughts or examples to share on that end.
Maybe I'll start. So Bob is a great example of someone who has created programs that are especially designed at those populations. We do a lot of that too. I guess a couple of thoughts. One is, one of the things we do a poor job of in healthcare is stratification, right? So we have this sort of misguided in the notion of equality, one size fits all model thing, but a primary care practice, you do all things to all people, right? Healthy young people and very complex people, they all have the same visit length. You know, they have a 20-minute visit, the same support staff. And of course, that's silly, right? No other industry thinks you treat everyone the same way. You will treat people according to their need. And taking care of a complex, multiply chronically ill, socially, you know, problematic person is just fundamentally different than healthy 23-year-old yuppies. So one thing is we have to start thinking about different models of care for different people. On the first part, that 10% of people are driving 2/3 of the cost, you know, we can't spend enough money on them, right, to keep them out of the badness on the back end. And so we need to, you know, primary care prevention is 5% of the healthcare dollar in the U.S., and that's just ridiculous, particularly for that group of people. And we need, I think Bob and I found, you need 10 or 15% of the healthcare dollar, double or triple that up front in the primary care, and you'll save way more than that downstream in keeping people out of badness, right? So the number one point I made before is you need to have enough of a time horizon to be able to benefit from that, right? The second point is, I think it's really important to take care of the sickest people, but if that's all we do, we will keep filling the funnel back up, right? Yes, we should take care of them, but the real opportunity in U.S. healthcare is to prevent people from becoming those people, right, eventually. Now again, that's not a 1 or 2 year game, that's a 5 or 10 year game. But if you could do that right, I think that's hugely impactful. And by the way, that's a different intervention than taking care of the sicker people. So again, mm-hmm. you need to think about this in a very different way. And there are a number of folks around the country, entrepreneurial, who are, you know, who are trying to do these things, you know, often quite successfully. I think the point, unfortunately, is the way our health system is set up, the, you know, the big health systems were largely, you know, when we set up these ACOs, they're largely based in hospital systems and they get a lot of the attention. You can imagine if you're a hospital-based system and you make most of your money off filling hospital beds, you are not that motivated to actually do any of what we are talking about. And actually, you are probably demotivated to do any of this. You make money off filling hospital beds. That's a huge, huge problem.
Yeah, absolutely. So are there, is there anyone who is actually innovating in a positive way on the front to help bring people more towards the front of that system and not just let them, you know, not just take care of them when they are that sick?
Let me just jump in and elaborate a little bit more. And I want to thank Rashika for his kind words. First of all, it does start with those that need an awful lot of care because of their medical and social challenges. So, and that, as Rashika pointed out, 10 or 15% of the population is 50 to 60% of the dollars. And I think that's one reason I think you heard some silence here when you said, what about these volunteer networks? If we can just fill up the panels of docs, isn't that good? And yes, I think that is good. But what we're talking about is a care system that is needed, that is far beyond just getting a slot in a physician's office.
Right.
If you are having people near the end of life, and studies have shown that, particularly the Dartmouth Atlas, the amount of futile care and cruel futile expensive care in the last 6 months of people's lives is extraordinary. And what is needed there is a team model and team approach and working in communities. And as Kavita and Rashika pointed out, they have to vary, and it's by state, by its local political economy and ecology and the like. But you need that to essentially offer palliative care options that don't exist. And that requires clinical teams, that requires allocation of resources, individualized care plans, better use of Medicare and Medicaid dollars and the like. And so it requires a system if you're gonna do that. The next question is, how do you move a step back from the sickest that are inappropriate, you know, in terms of ineffective care, where, and I use end of life care, where obviously a goal for more effective care would be to shift final end of life care from out of the hospital, out of the intensive care unit, into home and communities, and where one is living in some way that's consistent with their life and their values. And it's also far less expensive to do that. But how do you get there earlier? How do you intervene in that person that's been smoking for two packs a day for 40 years before they are essentially bed to chair and oxygen requiring just to survive? And that is a reimagining of what primary care is. But again, it's not just getting a slot in a doctor's office and filling that. That's just the same old, same old. It's actually, quite frankly, a lot of the work that Rashikar has done in his organization and we've done in ours to rethink the resources that make primary care effective and the redistribution of healthcare dollars into funding those resources, as Rashikar said, has to be 2x, 3x, 4x over what's being paid today for that doctor that gets two extra patient slots for a 20-minute visit.
Hmm. So actually, even going a step further back, one of the questions that we got very recently from Vicky Gatsoulis is about, you know, asking, do you think the media is doing enough to educate the public about what's involved in improving public health? So going beyond, you know, just even primary care visits to things like housing, transportation, public safety, trauma. So do you have a sense of, like, is the media doing enough to help make these connections clearer? And if not, what do you think journalists could do better? Any
short answer? No. Yeah. This is, I mean, I'll say two words here. So the answer is no. So if you look at what's happened, we always point to the fact in Europe and other developed countries, they have half the healthcare costs per capita than we do at better outcomes, right? So why is that? But one of the things, if you look at spending, we spend twice as much on healthcare as social services in this country, and they spend twice as much on social services as we do on healthcare, and they get better outcomes. So again, I think part of what people like Bob and I are trying to do is we need to dramatically fix the problems of these folks who are driving all the costs, who are complex set of social issues. Medical care is often not the thing we should be spending on. And the problem is, for whatever reason in this country, people don't seem to get that, and we keep focusing on medical care. So what we need to do is get money out of the medical care system, paying doctors, hospitals, you know, high-tech stuff, and get it into sort of trying to fix these underlying social problems, which actually will then fix the problem, right? And I think, unfortunately, the way the rules are written, that's almost impossible to do. I think, you know, there's all these rules as a doctor. If you spend money on things and people, they think it's illegal because you're trying to, you know, sort of encourage them to come to you, but really you're trying to fix their problem. So I think blurring lines in social services and public health is something we need to do much more of in this country, and I haven't seen much coverage of that.
I would like to just add this thought. I think the stories are very important. If journalists could actually focus on the stories of what is or isn't happening to individuals, and I guess we're focusing on people with the most complex medical and social needs, and those examples where a public health focus or an integrated focus with community and home supports and social services is making a difference, and we certainly could point to enough examples where that's the case, I think that would be an extraordinary benefit to the public in understanding the kind of issues that we're talking about today.
Yeah. So before we move on, the last topic I want to get to is the politics of healthcare. But before we move on, I just wanted to get to one more of the questions that came in from Keith Hammonds, who we heard from at the top of the hour, about preventative care. He asks, are there countries where the percent of spending on preventive care is in fact as high as 10 or 15%? And what does that actually look like in real life? If you're not aware, then I guess if none of you are aware, then I think this is a great area for any journalist who's watching this to actually to start exploring.
So other countries, so it's, there is no, like, you can't find a study that says the Netherlands spent 15% of their dollars on preventive care and the US only spent like 2% because different countries classify preventive care in different ways. And then I think what Rashika and I'll just tell you, like, the fact that if I do a preventive visit in my clinic, and I did one yesterday, I 100%, and Rashika and Bob know this, I can actually, I have been taught to try to find a way to get to some of the acute issues or problems that the patient is having, because if I add that in, I get paid, you know, like 1.6 times more than that. So most of our visits in the United States may have some preventive element. I talk to someone about a mammogram. I talk to them about losing weight. But the truth is that I can't get paid what I can get paid if I can also find out if they actually have a freckle that they're worried about, or if they have a joint pain in their knee. So we do not have, if any of the people on the webinar are accountants, we do not have what I would call kind of true cost accounting, and especially in primary care. And Rashika and Bob have probably already read Atul Gawande's article around primary care, but I don't think there's enough reporting that has gone on. You're talking to three primary care physicians. Nobody understands how incredibly complex it is to survive in primary care. And when Nick asks the questions about preventive care, I've got news for you. You do not see interventional cardiologists rushing to do preventive care because we don't pay for it. So it all falls on the backs of primary care clinicians. And I just spoke with a graduating class at Johns Hopkins in the medical school. None of them want to go into primary care. Why? Because we've set it up the way Rashika's described it. It is absolutely accurate. I'm on a treadmill, forced to see patients every 15 minutes, and I've been given guidelines and a PowerPoint on how I can figure out how to get the most money out of that through coding and all these things that have nothing to do with preventive care. So you're never going to see a Lancet article or a BMJ article that says 15% of our dollars go to this or 20% of our dollars go to this, because all our dollars really are dedicated to sickness care, not preventive care, not health care. And that's how we do a cost accounting around the world primarily.
Wow, that is fantastic framing. Rashika, looks like you're trying to say something.
Yes, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, so one of the things that the ACA did was try to say that preventive care will be covered 100%. And so, for instance,
your voice is really low for me. I'm sure, I'm guessing two feathers.
Oh, how's that? Can you hear me better?
Yeah, much better.
Yeah, so the ACA has done some funny things. So they said we're going to cover preventive care 100%, and health plans have to cover that. The problem is the line is very fuzzy. So the great example, which happens all the time, is a patient comes in and you want to do a colonoscopy as preventive care to see if they have colon cancer. And they say, okay, that's great. So they do the colonoscopy, and if truly they find nothing, it's preventive and it's paid 100% by the insurance company. If they find one little thing, all of a sudden it is not a preventive service anymore. It is now a therapeutic colonoscopy. And now all of a sudden the patient's responsible for that whole bill. They've got a $2,000 bill if they're in a high deductible plan. But you, of course, don't know that going in, right? So I think this line, trying to make these lines in preventive and not preventive care, gets us into trouble.
I guess the one thing that I would add to that in the years of experience I've had, again, working with and trying to care for the most low-income populations with the greatest medical and social challenges, is that oftentimes the best strategy for preventive care is not that doctor visit at all. And I think this is echoing what I've heard before. For example, how do we build the bonds of trust with a lot, and this is highly relevant today with our opioid crisis, people with significant substance abuse challenges and mental health challenges and intermittently homeless or not so intermittently. And there we find the bridges are not a medical care system, but people in their own world, peer supports, peer counseling, community health workers, some really interesting and important work being done in that area. And I just want to say, if we think about preventive care, this is not a measure that physicians are very familiar with, a HEDIS measure of how you manage the measure of diet, the ability to effectively manage sugar control and diabetes, or pap testing in women, but in fact, using other personnel that are in far more trusted relationships generally than professionals to promote kind of the principles of prevention is for many populations, I think, the way to think about this.
That is a wonderful reframing, and I think that's something that a lot of the journalists on the webinar could would be able to relate to. So we only have 14 minutes left, which is just enough time to talk about everything going on with politics of healthcare right now. So just wondering, there's a few questions on this. So Michael Zacharias asks, it seems that the central conservative argument today is Americans should get to choose exactly the kind of care they want and don't want on the free market rather than being told what to buy, which of course resonates with a lot of people. But can you briefly explain why the healthcare market is quite different from a supermarket and how journalists can help the average citizen understand this essential distinction? So any thoughts?
I think people who work inside of healthcare kind of appreciate how healthcare is not a true free market. And I think the most kind of illustrative way to point that out is the fact that patients, unlike other free market kind of scenarios in which you can rationally predict, economists will tell you, and scenarios in which you can rationally predict your ability to utilize a service like a supermarket because you know you get hungry at certain points and you're supposed to eat three times a day, you cannot generally rationally predict what your healthcare trajectory will be like. We can predict that we need certain preventive services at the age of 50, at the age of 65, at certain age intervals. But we generally, for looking at what causes us ailments, we can't predict that. And it's the same reason I think it's very difficult to ask people to enter into high deductible health plans or health savings kind of accounts, because that implies that there's an element of consumerism, that you can choose what you're doing. And I think that that's not 100% true. It's true to a point in health, but not 100%. Mm-hmm. And it also gets back, I keep coming back to people and asking them, most healthcare providers really do probably feel like intrinsically healthcare is a right and it's not a privilege. And so when we're making free market assumptions and free market comparators, generally speaking, free markets have a certain element of privilege associated with them. And so this is something that I think is distinct and different for other reasons.
I actually just don't understand how that applies to the world that we physicians live in. Let's just take this free market example. We have a 30-year-old person that is very, very healthy and basically has medical care needs that are very, very intermittent and infrequent. And we would say to that person, well, you don't need an insurance policy that could cover cardiovascular illness or that highly unlikely circumstance that you get an aggressive cancer that's going to need a lot of care. Or if you have an automobile accident and a spinal cord injury, because you don't have that. So why should you pay for that? And then what should you get this? Then you can then immediately trigger some kind of other insurance policy. Isn't that great? Except that when you get that, you don't have coverage for the care of that. And if you do that, the cost of that literally would probably be astronomical. And I think that misses the essential reality that we clinicians have, is that all of us are one misfortune away from a serious illness. We are one child away, from autism, or a parent away from advanced Alzheimer's needing a nursing home. We are all in this together, and we can't predict what happens for any of us. And what our needs are going to be. And so this just doesn't fit our human reality.
If we could just go broad more, just because we only have 10 minutes left. And I'm sure a lot of people who tuned in are curious to understand about all the recent goings on in Washington regarding healthcare. Are there any tips that you would give journalists who are interested in covering the politics of healthcare right now? Like, what are the things that, how can they separate the wheat from the chaff, and what are the things that they should make sure to focus on?
I'll just say in DC, I mean, there's so much kind of misinformation that's going around because now there's a resurgence of you know, Trump having called in Republicans last night to talk about other ways to repeal the Affordable Care Act. I think what's probably most important for journalists to do is to actually clarify the facts around what is currently the law. That's the Affordable Care Act. So There's a lot of misinformation about kind of the Affordable Care Act has resulted in everybody getting skyrocketing premiums. Actually, in the state of California, premiums have been held down to like single digits. And then I think what's also misinformation is people act as if before 2010, our healthcare system was perfect and we somehow went into like a complete ruin. So I think something that's really critical in reporting, and obviously I'm biased, I work on health reform, but I think as a scientist, it's objectively important to say, here's what healthcare was like before we had health reform. So when we look at kind of the quote effects of Obamacare, we have to do it in comparison to what was the state before that time. And that helps to deal with a lot of the misinformation. And then I would say with respect to the Republican proposals, both the American Healthcare Act and then this kind of revision that's occurring in Washington, D.C., I think that it's essential to talk to moderate Republicans because they're driving now a lot of the decision-making around what's getting in and what's getting out. And that's something that's getting lost. People are putting a lot of attention on the Freedom Caucus. Right. But a lot of what you see the White House trying to do is make deals with the moderate Republicans who have a lot more weight because they're not signing on to this.
Mm-hmm. Any other thoughts?
I just would say this very briefly. I think we're confusing what is a value conflict in politics with a policy conflict. In the policy conflict, we say, well, we can manage, there are different ways that we can perhaps get to the same outcome, which would be the equivalent of universal entitlement and the promotion of independence and autonomy to the maximum extent possible. But in fact, there's a value conflict around that. That I when you strip it away, I am seeing values that don't include the value of equity. For example, that is so important from the world I live in and where we come from, and that those who are quote with an honest job earning money should not be forced by the government to separate separated from their income to support those unworthy that can't, and that's a value conflict, and we need to be able to separate what's values and what's policy. And I think that's a very fertile area for journalism.
I love that idea. You know, and it kind of goes back to what Kavita was saying, how everything that she sees in healthcare is through the lens of whether about healthcare being a human right. So I really appreciate that. Rishika, sorry I interrupted you.
Yeah, no. So you know, going back a little bit to the last question about, and Bob mentioned about, you know, people need insurance. The reality is that that insurance isn't really insurance, right? So if it truly was just, I want to pay for the risk of something bad happening to me, well, we sort of do that. We buy what's called reinsurance on our patients so that if any individual goes over a certain amount, and that's actually pretty cheap. What really is happening, there are a group of people in this country who are sick, and they're going to spend a ton of money. And there is no way they could spend that themselves. And what insurance, what really is we are, this is reality, is having healthy people who are not going to spend a lot of money, you know, cross-subsidizing the people who are sick, right? Because that's the only way to do it. Again, and in most countries, virtually every other country, they acknowledge that we need to have a social transfer from the healthy to the sick. And the most efficient way to do that is through the tax system. And so it's a regressive, it's a tax that's progressive, and then that goes to pay for healthcare. We have this crazy system where we pretend it's insurance and we sort of do all these machinations of markets and all of that. And it's probably an incredibly inefficient way to do that, right? So again, I think if you're a healthy 30-year-old, in some ways, this is the core of the problem. As a healthy 30-year-old, actually talk to and assure you. Someone's not on mute, I think. The insurance is maybe $30 or $40 a month. but the premiums are $300 or $400. Yeah. And most of that premium is actually not going to insure you. It's actually going to help pay for the people who are in the pool who actually need help.
Fantastic points. It's 12:55 now, so I'm wondering if any of you have any final thoughts or ideas that you wanted to share before we turn it back over to Keith. So any advice, any final advice you would give journalists who are interested in covering healthcare now, maybe just any thoughts on different ideas that they should, how they should be focusing their coverage right now?
Three little pearls. One is kind of the lack of healthcare literacy. So I think there have been some stories on it, but it's amazing to understand. Part of our, healthcare is complicated. Part of that complexity is that, unlike everything in education, we don't really teach people anywhere along the role of their lives what healthcare is. Like, even when I, as a very, very knowledgeable health person, got my explanation of benefits form for insurance, it's completely confusing and backwards. And how do you expect regular people with no degree of healthcare experience to do that? The second pearl is around the number of other programs that exist. Like in the Medicare program, we have the Medicare Advantage program, which is like the private insurance model of Medicare. A lot of people kind of don't talk about that program or the distinctiveness of the growth of that program. And then the third, I would say I'm going to still be an advocate for people who are undocumented or the millions who are going to continue to remain uninsured and how they are going to continue to get access that is desperately needed when, to be honest, many community health centers, many places no longer really even have a mechanism to take uninsured patients, including my own clinic. So I think those are three areas that could merit from a better set of stories.
Thank you so much.
And I would jump in and just say, start with the story. Start with real people, their lives, what the healthcare system is and isn't doing in terms of better meeting their lives or are. And then from there, extrapolate to policy and then to values.
And I completely agree. And the two other points I would make is when people like particularly existing providers or health plans are saying they're doing innovation, be really, really skeptical. There's a lot of people saying they're doing things. Really get to, are they actually doing things? Is actual care actually changing for people? If not, I would discount it. And finally, I think Bob's point is great. Get to the values. A lot of these discussions going on in healthcare aren't really about healthcare. They're about values and about what people value, tax cuts for people versus spending it on healthcare and vulnerable people. So get to the bottom of what they're really saying.
Absolutely. If I can just also say a couple of things that I've learned new from this whole conversation. One, that healthcare is not like Starbucks. It cannot be, you cannot just have one franchise, that every community has different needs. And often we need to look from the bottom up. Number two, that preventive healthcare is really important, but it's very hard to quantify. And our current system, not just in the US, but around the world, seems to be more sickness care rather than healthcare. And number three, a point that it seems like all three of you made several times, that everything that we're talking about in healthcare really comes down to some core values of, what is a human right and what do people really deserve. So I hope that everyone on the call was able to get a lot out of this, get some story ideas. I certainly have. And thank you all so much for joining. I'll hand it over to Keith now.
Thank you, Sarika. That was a great conversation. Thanks to you and to all our panelists. I really appreciated deeply the sort of expert decoding of policy, but also the linkages he made between policy, healthcare practice, solutions, and what happens to real people in communities. That was just very powerful, and you guys could be great journalists. So thank you for that. Folks who joined the call, thank you as well. We will send out a link to an archived version of this conversation, as well as resources that we hope will help, in the way this call did, help you approach the challenge of covering healthcare and health policy from a solutions perspective. And we'll have that on our blog next week. Thanks for joining. I think that's it. That is it, I'm told. Thank you, everybody. Have a great day.